because I'm a member of Project 22, and Project 22 is a documentary that's been put together by NORML out of Missouri, and 22 veterans a day are committing suicide, and we're, you know, on the activist side of things and saying that vets need safe access to real medicine that actually works. And so, you know, a lot of people in our crew who are either currently on or have recently kicked, like, hardcore pharmaceuticals. Got a buddy here today who, like, he's off 10,000 pills a year, and he's doing it 100% with cannabis illegally in the state of Missouri. So, and, you know, my story goes way further than just the Project 22. I mean, I'm a veteran, I have PTSD, but my story starts because I received what whistleblowers are saying to be a tainted batch of anthrax vaccinations from 2000. So I have a questionable diagnosis, depending on which VA doc that you talk to, of melanoma, and I have been illegally curing myself with full extract cannabis oil that I basically educated myself on from, you know, starting with the Rick Simpson story and the processes that he's used. And from there, you know, I doing everything I could to hustle the product that I needed to, you know, put the medicine in my body. And in that, stumbled upon lots of different people from different walks of life who also needed it and benefited from it. So, what a politician might call an illegal drug ring, you know, but really, you know, nobody's getting high off anything. Everybody's healing themselves with, you know, real science that I hope to gain a fuller understanding of from here, you know. I mean, I followed instructions and watched my tumors dissolve, you know, so I'm really interested in finding out more about the science behind it. And you know, we're pushing for bills to be passed in Missouri. We're down in the Capitol every week, telling our stories, talking to lawmakers, and my goal is to provide free, safe, healthy, effective medicine to vets once we go full-on medicinal in Missouri, because the VA is not doing it. You know, the VA is not providing the help that people need. They're killing them directly or indirectly with, you know, cocktails of pharmaceuticals. And so I've always been a rebel, and I've always been a disruptor, even when I was in the military, and here we are, man. So I'm here getting all the knowledge I can and planning to fight the good fight. PTSD, post-traumatic stress disorder. The most simple way to describe it is I use a Play-Doh example. So Play-Doh's your brain, right? You take Play-Doh and you punch it, and now you have a permanent indention in that Play-Doh. So PTSD is that permanent indention into your brain that happens when you've been brain punched by life. And it's an actual physical neural, you know, change to the science of your brain that makes you act, feel, think differently than a normal person. Because, you know, I mean, a simple example, you know, a kid touching the hot stove, you know, you tell your kid not to touch it and they don't listen, and they touch it and it hurts really bad and they know never to touch that again, right? So from a combat veteran or a soldier who's been in intense situations, from that perspective, it's kind of like the same thing. You know, you're walking around looking for those, that burning hot stove, and making sure that you're not going to touch it, right? And so it's a state of being, man. Like, it literally changes the way you, and the way that you are. PTSD, like, it took me a long time to understand that I had it. I spent all of my military service waiting for engagement, and the engagement time that I had was like 0.2 seconds, right? So all of that training, all of that waiting, it's what you do, right? So the question, how did I learn that I had PTSD? Well, I honestly didn't know at first, man. When I got out of the military, you know, it's here I am, Billy Badass, right? So what do I do for a living? Well, let's go catch shoplifters, because I'm good at making sure that people don't hurt me, you know? So I did that for a little while and got into, I started going to school and got an internship underneath a psychology professor. And after that, went to work in the industry. And man, I started working with kids who all had PTSD, you know? And it was just like, wow. The amount of healing that I took from helping others, like, was incredible. But it really still wasn't even until, and I mean, I honestly have the VA to thank for understanding that I had PTSD, because I went in for strep throat and they started screening, you know, did you serve during this time? Do you ever feel like this? It's like, yes, yes, yes. It's like, okay, maybe there's something happening here. I mean, it took me a long time to get away from the habit of like clearing my home when I came in, you know, like military operations, urban terrain, making sure that there's, you know, nobody behind your shower curtain. My own routine for cannabis consumption when it comes to PTSD is simply staying medicated, because I have acute hypervigilance. So like, I mean, the house settling in a quietly over there attracts my attention over there, you know what I mean? And so when I medicate with a good indica, I mean, honestly, just CBDs and THC in general, like, I still recognize that stimuli, but I don't react to it. You know, my routine, I smoke all day. I get up, I smoke, I own my own business, and my bowl's sitting right there next to me, and it's, whenever I feel the need, I just hit it and move on. I work in a rather low stress industry, so, you know, I don't absolutely, like, have to be 100% focus on anything but what I want to focus on, because it's my business. So, yeah, I medicate all day, daily, and it absolutely helps. Now, since I started the Rick Simpson process, my usage has changed quite a bit. I still load a bowl and have it by my side all day, but I smoke dramatically less, because when I eat the oil, it medicates my whole body. And now it's just, I've got it to where it's a zero. I don't even get high off of it, you know? And so when I do smoke a little bit, it enhances all the medicine already in my body, and I catch that buzz that brings me the inner peace that I desire. It's an unfinished tattoo, actually. And there's a reason why it's unfinished. So my favorite tattoo is unfinished. The one that means the most is unfinished. And I would have to disrobe to show it to you. I guess I can.
If you're comfortable.
Yeah. I mean, it's kind of, I never got it finished. And there's a reason why I never got it finished. But
you want to tell me about it?
Yeah, well, it's a heart burning, or just extremely damaged, with this candle stuck through it that's burning at both ends, and it says fucked. I got that, man. I was at probably my most intense, like, drug and alcohol abuse level in my life, and like going through the most incredible, like, loss and turmoil and heartbreak, all 100% responsible, or 100%, it happened because I was using pills and whiskey, you know, and pain pills, man. And I tore my ankle, and the VA gave me about 250 horse pills of Vicodin, and I already had the whiskey, and man, I just ruined my life. I wrecked it, you know, lost everything. And marijuana saved my life. It really did, because I don't drink anymore, really. I have a glass of wine here and there, but and I don't use pharmaceuticals anymore. And that tattoo represents how I was feeling at the time. It was like, yeah, we're fucked. There's nothing positive coming out of any of this from here on out. So, and honestly, that's kind of why I never finished it. Because shortly after I got that tattoo, my, you know, things started to fall in line for me, and I started having an awakening, getting away from drug and alcohol abuse, pharmaceuticals, man, pills and 90 proof. And so the military taught me how to drink, and it taught me how to ask the doctor for pills, you know. So when I got out, I was two-fifths a day. And I was 2/5 a day because my favorite drink had both gin and vodka in it. So I had to buy 2/5 to make it properly. And cannabis, for soldiers, airmen, seamen, Marines, even the Coast Guard, I'm sure, self-medicating is the answer, the only answer they have. You know, the BX has all the booze in the world for sale 24 hours a day, and you have plenty of doctors you can ask for, you can tell them you're sick, and they'll try anything on you, you know? And first time I smoked was about a month and a half before I got out of the military. And it didn't do anything to me because my brain had never received THC yet. And then when I got out, I hit the bottles hard when I got out. But it was the introduction of marijuana added to the party cocktail that the older I got and the more mature I got, the more I realized what was good for me and what wasn't, you know. And I made a lot of really bad decisions on drugs and alcohol. And man, thank God for weed.
All right, George Biswell. I'm here with a group called Project 22, which is sponsored by Greater St. Louis NORML. And the idea was to bring 22 veterans here because 22 veterans a day and all commit suicide every day in the United States. I bring pamphlets and things like that about our organization and what we're trying to do in the state to legalize medical cannabis and things of that nature. And that's why I'm here, to get all the facts that I can to take back to my state and convince folks that what you folks here in Colorado have, we want in Missouri. I use my own personal experience of using the product for almost 50 years now. And the beginning was a recreational thing, but now, because of ailments and the things, it really works. It lowers my anxiety issues, unbelievable. And it's for our veterans. How can you turn down a veteran, a person who wore the uniform, so that you can stand here and ask me this question? So it's for our veterans. Our veterans are dying 22 a day. And this, we believe, as veterans and as members of the cannabis activist group, this is something that will save lives. I love getting people to say, whoa, I didn't know that it helped with Parkinson. My grandfather has Parkinson. You mean to tell me it would help with his shakes? I said, absolutely. And I say, go online, take a look at this video, take a look at that video. I get questions like, well, aren't you sure? Are you sure people, that, you know, they might lead to something else? And so it gives me a conversation to say, you know, well, by that, if you're saying that because someone who smokes cannabis will then go to heroin or cocaine, by that fact, we've had 3 presidents who have used cannabis. So I would say that smoking cannabis leads you to be president of the United States. In 1976, one of my good veteran buddies, a Navy, came to me and said, man, I need to get some smoke for my dad. He's going through chemotherapy. He's got stage 4 cancer. I want to make him, you know, I've been reading about it, and I know you're involved with NORML. Can you help me out? Can you come and talk to my dad? So I went and talked to this World War II vet. He was a Marine in World War II. I had a commonality with him because I had an uncle who lost his life on the islands over there somewhere in the Pacific. And so he was a Marine, so we was able to connect there. So I began to explain to him that this will help you. So instead of having smoking the product, because he had lung cancer, that's kind of, you know, weird. Hey, smoke this and help you, you know. So I made my homemade brownies. And from that point on, and at the end of his life, on his deathbed, he says to me, why didn't I know you 20 years ago? What? He said, this is... You have made my life bearable. He said, I'm dying, we know that. I'm not gonna get cured of this. So I know from personal experience, it works. If you want more information about Kansas City NORML or what we're trying to do, I would recommend you go to newapproach.org. That is the organization we set up to work to get medical cannabis in Missouri. And it seems to work. They kind of did it in Colorado. They did it in... So we've been working with these folks in Colorado and folks who are, you know, your folks out here, the people who have worked for making it. So we're, you know, you guys, the folks in Colorado have already created the train. So we don't need to redo that. We just need to get on the train and ride it further. So we, you know, that's what we're doing.
My name is Jamie Kaz. I'm the executive director of NORML Kansas City, and I'm also the board secretary of New Approach Missouri, and I'm here with Missouri's Project 22. NORML is the National Organization for the Reform of Marijuana Laws. It's been around since the 1970s, and NORML Kansas City is just a local chapter of the national organization. Project 22 is an organization that was put together by Blake Bell of Greater St. Louis NORML, and it is bringing 22 veterans together from Missouri to travel to Colorado for this conference to learn about cannabis and to be able to bring it back into their communities and really educate. And 22, that number, because there's 22 veterans that complete suicide each day in the United States. Well, an average day for me looks like, you know, I'm trying to get volunteers right now to gather signatures for the New Approach Missouri initiative to get medical cannabis on the ballot for 2018. So that's a lot of work because right now we're working on a grassroots level, so educating the people about that. Taking phone calls from volunteers, from people who just have general questions about cannabis, answering emails. And right now, we actually just got done decriminalizing cannabis in Kansas City, Missouri. We did that by an overwhelming percentage of 75, which was completely incredible, considering that we did that with less than $700 and about 15 people. So it just goes to show what a small group of activists can do if they put their heart and minds to it. Decriminalization is very important because what that truly does, that's the first step of removing the stigma associated with cannabis. Because when you're arrested for a cannabis offense, you're automatically stigmatized. And what we did in Kansas City is decriminalization, which was simply to reducing the current penalties for marijuana possession. It's not legalizing it, it's just reducing the penalties. So this way, like under what we're doing in Kansas City, it will no longer be a felony or a misdemeanor. It would just be a city ordinance violation. So no jail time. And that helps communities tremendously and families. By May 2018, that is going to be a huge month for us for New Approach Missouri, because that is the time that we are handing in all of our signatures to be on the ballot for November 2018. So if we have all of our signatures in, then it's pretty much guaranteed that it's going to be the people are going to vote for it, because our polling shows that the people in Missouri are ready for medical cannabis. I've always been supportive of cannabis reform for a long time, but I wasn't using my voice. I was just, you know, at home kind of keeping tabs on what was happening. And then within the past few years, I've lost my father. He suffered from seizures. He'd had a stroke. I'd lost my grandfather. He passed away from cancer. And I don't know if cannabis could have saved their lives, but I know it could have given them a better quality of life. So that was one of the main turning points. And then I came out here to Colorado and visited some dispensaries and was completely blown away. And when I came back to Missouri, I'm like, I am ready to fight. And that's what I did. I contacted NORML. We didn't have a local chapter, and the rest is what I did. We just got it started and we got it done. And I am completely proud of everything that we've accomplished as our little chapter. But you know, that was the main turning point, because I'm doing this for patients, because there's patients out there that their lives depend on it or their children depend on it, and we need to help them first and foremost. Our website, which is normalkc.org, you can find out all that's going on about Kansas City reform, what we have going on as a chapter, what you can do to help, volunteer, donate. newapproachmissouri.com is where you can actually go read the medical cannabis initiative. You can also sign up to volunteer on that too and donate. And then project22.org is where you can go and find out about Project 22.
Well, my name is Joshua Lee. I'm from Holt Summit, Missouri, and I came out here with project22.org, a offshoot of the Greater St. Louis NORML organization. We're an organization that they gathered 22 veterans in honor of the 22 Veterans Day who commit suicide and funded a trip out here to help educate us and make a documentary to help educate Missourians about the beneficial effects of medical marijuana. The documentary itself, what I'm hoping that we'll be able to do is educate Missourians on the actual science and data behind this. There's a lot of anecdotal evidence to support a lot of good things about it, but science and data does show, like, there's even a correlation between increased use of cannabis and the onset of heart attacks. It protects your heart from heart attacks, but there is a correlation that shows it can trigger a heart attack in younger people. We still don't know enough about it to be able to make a conclusion, but hey, we need to study it. This is science and data that people need to know. Science and data. Medical states, opioid overdoses go down 25 to 28%. Veteran suicides get cut by 50%. We know this, we're still trying to figure out why. Hopefully this documentary is gonna show some of our stories and how we feel that this can help us, and here's why. This is a picture I posted on social media. That is a bag of 9,828 Smarties. That's how many pills the VA prescribes me every year. There's uppers, downers, SSRIs, MAOIs, opiates, narcotics, muscle relaxers, probably close to $1,000 worth of street drugs every month. All I want is I want to give that up for the chance to be able to buy my own marijuana. Because while I'm out here in Colorado, I feel like myself again. You know, I get to interact with my wife in a way I haven't in years, because these drugs turn me into a zombie, but they're the best chance I have to make a better life for my family back home. You know, without them, I'm not a good person. And they're killing me. And they kill thousands of people a year, you know? Veterans on that kind of pills are, we face a 40% higher risk of dying from sudden stroke or heart attack or aneurysm. On average, we're losing 15 years off of our life expectancy, destroying your liver, your body, your kidneys, I mean, you name it. You know, because you start off with, like myself, I have PTSD, fibromyalgia, and arthritis. A few other piddly things, but that's the whole unholy trifecta. So here's some painkillers and some muscle relaxers and something to help you sleep at night, something to help you wake up. And then you have side effects, and you got to help control those side effects. And then those pills have side effects, so let's throw some pills on top of those. And now your painkillers aren't working strong enough, so let's up it. You know, let's put you on 2,000 milligrams of tramadol a day. Or let's move you onto oxys or morphine or whatever else. Why? Marijuana is a truly self-tailored medication. Joshua on those pills is worthless. Can't get much done around the house. Really has to be guarded with strangers or even my own family, because, I mean, they help, but it's not like they're perfect. You know, they're just symptom control is all they are. They're quality of life medications. And the side effects they cause are just as bad as what's on them. You know, I come out here to Colorado and I've discussed it with my doctors, my psychiatrist, about how to safely step it down. It's like, never advocate going cold turkey on anything, ever. That's a bad juju, okay? But I step it down when I come out here, like even on this trip. You know, my wife and I spent our 15-year anniversary out here. And I get to smile and laugh. And, you know, here I'm at a conference with 500 people attending, crammed into tiny rooms. And yeah, I'm a little stressed. I had to come out and woosaw a bit. But back home in Missouri, I can't go to Walmart for an hour, let alone be in public for this long. Stop killing us. Stop killing the veterans. Stop killing the kids with epilepsy. Stop killing the people with autism. Right now, we've got a right to trial law for CBD that says, sure, you can try CBD if you've gone through three other medications first. Well, you read the stories of what that does to these kids with epilepsy. The three medications they have to try fry their brains and makes them less functional permanently for life before they even have a chance to try CBD legally. What they do on their own is up to them. But if my child had epilepsy, I know what I'd be doing. There's no way I'd be poisoning them. That's why I'm fighting. I don't want to have to feed my kids meth every morning before I send them to school. You know, what are the long-term consequences of that? We don't know. There haven't been a lot of studies done on that. We just give our kids whatever the doctors tell us to give them. And mind you, my kids medically do need it. But I'm still giving them methamphetamines every morning. And if I don't, the school calls me and demands that I do. Wouldn't it be better if we could isolate a cannabinoid or terpene and THC of marijuana that has the same effect, but far fewer health benefits, health risks? Give us the chance to be in control of our own bodies and our own medications. Give us the right to listen to our doctors instead of a fear-based policy from the 30s. I think probably one of the funniest things I encounter when I talk to people about medical marijuana is when they insist that medical marijuana is non-psychoactive. They take it all out. I'm like, no, that's CBD oil. No, all medical marijuana is non-psychoactive. No, it's kind of the point of marijuana is it's psychoactive. But if you're really worried about psychoactive drugs, caffeine is the most widely used and abused psychoactive substance in the world. Good luck outlawing that one. You're worried about people getting high? Why are you handing me tramadol? Guarantee you, I get high when I eat my pills. Worried about what I might do if I eat more than one of them? Well, guess what? It says on the bottle I can eat more than one. You're worried about people might process hemp into something they can get high on? Go give me a bushel of corn, I'll make you some moonshine. What are you worried about? Worst case scenario, people are gonna feel great and have a great placebo effect. That's the worst case scenario. I've been deployed, wound up getting medically retired out of the military, and they broke me, didn't want to keep me. I'm too broken to do anything with my life. What did I want to do? I didn't have a purpose. I had no hope. I mean, my hope is 10,000 pills a year now, and I'm 33 years old. What am I going to be doing when I'm 50? And now I found a fight. And it's not just for me. It's not just for veterans. I'm fighting for all patients' rights. So when people look at me, I don't want them to see a victim. I want them to see someone who is standing up for himself and taking a stand in his home state, saying no, no more. I'm tired of seeing people suffer and die because they don't have access to a medicine that can save their lives. That's what I want people to see.